A very warm welcome to episode 5 of the Eagles Nesting. Thank you so much for all of your comments and getting involved on social media. I hope you're enjoying these memories as much as we all are. We'd love to hear from you as well, particularly if there's any Eagles games you'd love to have pulled out of the archives. We've got loads of great basketball games with our Eagles, whether it is from the Metro Radio Arena Sports Central or at the ECA that we can bring to you. And perhaps if there's some certain Eagles players you'd love to hear from and get their memories back again, well, we'll try and sort that out for you as well. Just get in touch by commenting on social media, on Twitter, or just below this if you're on Facebook or YouTube. YouTube is where you can watch the full game that we're going to be talking about in just a minute straight after this interview. So if you're on Facebook, hop over there and you can watch the whole thing. In tonight's edition, we're going back to the 2006-2007 season. It was the year after we did the clean sweep. We finished third in the championship. I think that was down to a head-to-head, only missed out, I think, by one game at the end. We were semi-finalists in the cup, runners-up in the trophy, but champions in the playoffs. And it's a repeat of that previous season playoffs final as well. The Scottish Rocks are our opposition again. Only this time, the playoff final actually was a home game at the Metro Radio Arena, as you'll see in just a bit. We've got two of our players from that season joining us right now when we won that playoffs for the third successive time in that big game against the Rocks. First of all, I want to welcome a very well-known name across the BBL, starting with the Birmingham Bullets in the mid-90s, then joining us back from Europe and then playing a few clubs around the BBL until his retirement. Please welcome to the Nestins, Tony Dorsey. Hi, Tony.
Hey, how you doing?
Hey, it's great to have you here. Thank you so much for doing this. Also joining us from that same Eagles team, it was his rookie season at the time before going on to play across Europe for a number of years. Please welcome Shawan Robinson.
Hey, how you doing, Dan?
Hey, Shawan, thank you so much for doing this. Tony as well. I'll start with you first of all, Tony. I mean, this must be the first time you and Shawan have probably talked and seen each other since that time. You played in the BBL for a long time, Tony, and you must have seen quite a few changes through those years and then looking at us from the outside now.
Yeah, I've seen a lot of changes. When I first got there, I think most of the fans and the media was calling it the high point of British basketball. The Sky Sports was heavily involved, and most of the teams up and down the country were very competitive. I think it was, like you said, it was a great time for British basketball. Had arenas with 10,000 fans and at some of the games, and the atmosphere was awesome.
Shawan, you were in your rookie season with our Eagles at the time, and you know, you stepped up on court as an Eagle. What was that like for you, being a part of that team for your first pro gig?
For me, it was a blessing. You know, knowing that the Eagles had the tradition that they did. Knowing that I was coming into a good situation, it was a blessing. You know, we had guys like Fab, and we had some legends that I got a chance to learn a lot from, and things that I'm able to use now, even as a coach. So, I mean, it was a very good experience for me.
Tony, as I say, you played with Fab at Birmingham, didn't you, when you first came to the BBL, is that right? Obviously Fab, that was then under Nick Nurse, who now obviously Fab is with at the Toronto Raptors. What was that like, being a part of that team in the early days, particularly because the spotlight obviously has been on that and the history of the Birmingham Bullets around about Nick's time with him having ascended to the NBA?
Right. it was my first season back from Europe that Fab was already on the team. So I actually went to Germany for a few months and came back and rejoined the Bullets. Most thing I remember about Fab is just how hard he played. Didn't care about points, didn't care about any stats, only cared about winning. And I think he carried that into his coaching career.
People might not remember that obviously the format of some of the games and competitions was a little bit different from season to season. In this season, the playoffs game that we're going to play in just a second, so you can see you guys and Fab in action, was actually part of a finals weekend. It was hosted at home at the Metro Radio Arena for our Eagles. It must have been a pretty special weekend if you can think back to being a part of that competition, the chance to win the playoffs title, and doing it at home?
I mean, yeah, definitely. Especially after, like you said, coming up short in the other two trophies. So having an opportunity to win the championship on your home floor is always big, always special, and just thankful that we could do it in front of the fans of Newcastle.
If you think back to that game, Shawan, when you were going out, and I think in that weekend, it was the Sheffield Sharks in the semi-final on the Saturday, before then you played the Scottish Rocks on the Sunday. Tough to play two big games like that back-to-back in the same weekend.
Yeah, you know, the way that, you know, Fab had prepared us, you know, the way we practiced, you know, we prepared for two tough games. I do remember, you know, it being a disappointment that we didn't get the clean sweep again, and it was kind of our last chance to make things right. But it was a good weekend. You know, I know we came victorious on top of both, and it was almost like a relief when we won it because, you know, the success that the program has had over the years, that we were able to continue that.
You played with our last guest on the Nest in just earlier in the week, Olu Babalola, in college. I think that's right, Shawan. Is that right? Did I get that?
Yeah. I mean, I know Olu 4 years before we played together, and you know, the fact that I was able to have him as a housemate my rookie year was really good for me as far as making the adjustment, you know, to playing as a professional.
What was it like playing for the Eagles in those early years then? I mean, you know, the program of the Eagles had only been Eagles and only in Newcastle for about 6 or 7 years at this point. Did it feel like you were part of building something special?
Yeah. I mean, I know I felt like I was joining part of something. You know, I felt like I was, you know, already becoming a part of something special, that it was, you know, they had already laid the groundwork, and it's kind of a little bit of a pressure to make sure that, you know, you were able to keep, you know, continue that success.
I think Lou got MVP in the playoffs game that we're going to play. Both you guys put points on the board, though. You were a huge shooter, Shawan, at the time, shooting from way down court. I think you put up 16 points in this game. I've been trying to hunt for the clip when I think you pretty much scored a three-pointer. I think it was at home earlier on in the season against Guildford from way, way deep from the halfway line, I think it was.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, nah, I'd remember that. I remember that as well. It was a big shot.
What was it like, Tony, going into the locker room at halftime against the Rocks in that playoff final? It was pretty tight in that game. We were, I think, just a couple of points in it. It must have been a case of going in there and really firing yourself up for the second half, like we know that Fab can do.
Like you said, we had a team full of veterans and a lot of guys had been there before. So the pressure was just making the adjustments and coming out and, you know, and carrying out the game plan. Having veterans on your team, you've been through every situation possible in a basketball game. So it's just a matter of staying calm and, like I said, carrying out the game plan. And that's what we did in the second half.
For any perhaps Manchester Giants, Bullets, former fans, lots of teams are around the BBL that you played with and against. Tony, you must have got some great memories from playing in Britain.
Oh, definitely. Actually, earlier this morning, John McCord and myself was talking on the internet as well. Keith Robinson, his daughter played in the same conference as our coach, so we got a chance to see him as well as his wife. John White from time to time, so I bump into quite a few guys that played in the BBL. Roy Harrison and I are still great friends and talk to Tony Holly every now and then as well. So, like I said, it's a small circle, but we tend to stay in touch.
That's great to hear some names and some memories. And this playoffs game must have been pretty special for you guys, obviously, both getting that win when you're in that sort of first season, both of you with the Eagles. Shawan, I mean, lifting that trophy alongside these guys, I think you guys probably both got more minutes as well. We had TJ was out with a broken hand, I think, at the time. I think Jeremy J. High went off with an injured calf or something. So you put everything into this game and this last sort of triumph from that finals weekend.
Yeah, I mean, I knew we had enough. I knew I was around a bunch of vets, and also knew that, you know, I had been through the battles in college. You know, I played college at a pretty high level. So making those adjustments at halftime and being able to put that trophy up, you know, your freshman year is the only championship I won as a professional. So it was definitely, you know, one of the high moments of my career.
Well, Shawan, it was great to hear some of your memories. Great to see you again. And we're looking forward to seeing you in action in the game we've got coming up in just a second. Final word from you, Tony, thinking back to this game, your time in the BBL, what would you say perhaps is like the highlight of your career in British basketball? It doesn't have to be with the Eagles. I know you won some trophies early on with the Giants as well. What was it like?
I think stopping the Towers from getting the clean sweep and my first Wembley championship. I think that was definitely the highlight. Towers were a great team. They were predicted to win everything, and we just came up big in Wembley. We were a team that really enjoyed playing with each other, a real close bunch of guys. I think we won close to 20 games in a row. Like I said, it was a special time, and a special time for British basketball.
Oh, Tony, thank you so much for joining us today. It's been great to hear from you. Shawan as well, both of you, and to all your families and friends, please stay safe, and really appreciate you taking part and joining the Nestins today.
All right, thank you. Thank you for having me.
Thanks for the invite, and great talking to you as well as you, Shawan. Good to see you.
Be good. I just sent you a request on Facebook.
All right, man.
Thank you, guys. And maybe an Eagles Legends game at the ECA coming up in our future as well. We'd love to see you guys both back on court on Tyneside as well. So here we go then. While you are all staying at home, protecting the NHS and, of course, saving lives, we hope you enjoy the game we've got coming up for you. We have got to go back today to Sunday, the 29th of April, 2007, for our 2007 BBL Playoffs Trophy win. It's at home at the Metro Radio Arena. Enjoy the game.
Welcome to Newcastle. It's the climax of the British basketball season, the BBL Championship playoff final between the Newcastle Eagles and the Scottish Rocks, the two teams out and ready to go. And in terms of seeding, it's 3-4. It may not be the final that everybody expected, but it promises to be a great final between two really fierce rivals. We're off and underway. Newcastle will have the first offense, and Vince McCauley, this really promises to be a great game.
Very, very exciting. Tony Dorsey immediately for the Newcastle Eagles, looking to establish their game under the basket, but the Scottish Rocks off and running.
Rob Yander's pushing it down court for the first score of the final. Newcastle, this is their home court. You would think that give them some advantage, but in the trophy final, that wasn't the case. They lost the trophy final to Plymouth. Do you like the Eagles here today?
Well, it's an interesting one, Daniel, because the Eagles are having to deal with a lot of mental problems, because they're going to have to be tough mentally. First of all, four championships last season. They win today, they retain one. They lose them all, Daniel, and that's a big call for them. Home advantage, I'm not so sure which one's going to outweigh one, especially as you said, after the loss in the trophy final.
Two teams pretty desperate to finish the season with some silverware and a great start. I noticed the Sheffield fans who stayed on from the 3-4 game are supporting the Rocks here because of Davis and Yanders, who are the first two scorers, ex-Sheffield players.
Exactly, and Coach Liebenath for the Scottish Rocks is going to be excited because his two best players, Yanders and Davis, have already put some points on the board, showing that they're helping the young fellas settle down.
A lot of that, you think, in these big games is about who settles best in the early stage. Good ball inside. And Bollers likes to live out on the three-point line, that time going into the low block.
Absolutely, Daniel. The Rocks already scoring some layups, getting some fouls under the basket. Straight away, those butterflies will be gone. They'll feel like this is where they belong right now.
The other thing about it is you look at the rosters of the two teams. We've already mentioned Sterling Davis and Rob Yanders, but also Julius Joseph. Been around a long time, played a lot of big games. Other side of the coin, you've got Fab on the ball here, Tony Dorsey, Jeremy Hyatt, guys who know what this big occasion is all about.
You're quite right, Daniel. And here's a guy who doesn't know what the big occasion is like in the shape of Tom Sherlock, traveling violation, unable to capitalize on that drive to the basket. It's going to be a big ask here from Newcastle. They're going to have to get their legs back under them. They're not the youngest of teams in comparison to the Scottish Rock, so back-to-back games, it's going to be important for them.
Nice drive to the basket from Hampton, draws the foul from Hyatt as he goes to the basket.
That's two fouls already on the Newcastle Eagles. They're going to pride themselves on their defense, and right now, it's not into first gear yet.
Hampton then at the free throw line. The one thing the Newcastle Eagles do have on their team is Tony Dorsey, and those of us who've been watching the game a long time will remember the playoff finals of 96, 98, 2000. Tony Dorsey, three playoff finals, three victories, three MVP displays. He's a big game player.
That's right. Tony Dorsey doesn't like to lose finals. He's already lost one this season to the Plymouth Raiders. He's not going to want to lose two. I'm really, really looking for him in the first three, four, 5 minutes to stamp his authority on this game, and right now he hasn't been able to do that. That's going to be interesting.
Renoy driving into the basket, off the hole, tipped by Sherlock, doesn't go. Dorsey with the offensive rebound and sticks back, and he had such a great game in the semi-final, Tony Dorsey. We're looking for more of that today.
On cue, Daniel, as he scores his first points of the game. He's happy to carry the team on his shoulders. He wants to show them that they can do this, so he's going to be really, really active in this first part of the game.
Yanders three doesn't go. Wallace with the rebound. Sterling Davis wearing the face mask. Kicks it out to Hampton. Hampton along the baseline out to Wallace. Good ball movement. Davis has it penetrating right through the heart of the defense. You can say Newcastle is a defensive team. Fab Renoy won't be happy with that.
He won't be happy. Having said that, they made the Rocks have to work. All players touched the ball. The ball moved a lot outside. Eventually, Sterling Davis, plenty of big match experience, makes it count.
Hyatt, little short on that spinning jump shot. Yanders out on the break again. Yanders is a good finisher on the break, and there he is, converting one and the foul called. That's an and one opportunity. He's really tough to stop in the open floor, Rob Yanders.
Well, that's three fouls, Daniel, on the Eagles, and all three of them have resulted in an and one. Real pressure now. Already the Eagles looking to go to the bench. Olu Babalola coming in now for Tom Sherlock.
Sherlock has really found himself promoted up through the team. He's starting player now ahead of the likes of Babalola. He goes out, plays hard, but when you've got somebody as big and physical as Babalola, it's a great plus off the bench.
Definitely. You're going to have to play Babalola, especially in this game, because the big men for the Scottish Rocks don't like to play in the key. They like to play on the three-point line. But I know Fabulous loves defense, and Tom Sherlock has really bought into that philosophy and plays hard on the defensive end.
There's a foul called against the Rocks. Sterling Davis, his first. But a very good start by the Scottish Rocks. Get up early. Can't let the Eagles get away, because if they get away, they get that momentum on their home court, they'll feel comfortable. So you've got to poach yourself early, which is exactly what they've done.
You're quite right, Daniel. Oh, there you go. Tony Dorsey didn't go for the hoop, elected to pass the ball to Babalola. Immediate impact on the game with a three-point shot.
Well, that's a basket they needed as well, Newcastle Eagles, though.
Absolutely. Sighs of relief all around, I reckon, from the Eagles fans. Pretty quiet right now.
Out to Wallace. He likes that three-point shot in the corner. That's why.
Daniel. That's the European style of basketball that Thorsten has brought to the BBL against the typical BBL style that Fabulous Flannoy likes.
Here's the player coach of the Eagles, Fab Flannoy. Dorsey wants it. He wanted it in the low post. He's had to come all the way out. Fab Flannoy for three. Doesn't go. That might come all the way back out to Fab. He wanted it a bit more. Spinning. Trying to get it into Dorsey. It's knocked away by Davis. It'll be an end-line ball to the Eagles.
What we saw there, Daniel, was Fab trying to impose his will on the game. He is that kind of a player. He's such a... He wears his heart on his sleeve. The Eagles love him for that. And he's trying to find a way for his team to get into the game.
And here we've got a and one at the other end as Jeremy Hyatt goes in.
That's absolutely critical, Daniel. Jeremy Hyatt is absolutely critical, because Tony Dorsey eventually will get his game going. Someone else has got to support him.
Hyatt converts a three-point play, and he's been such an effective player over the years in the BBL, because that extra little height makes him difficult for the guards to match up with in the low post. Here's Wallace again for three. That one's a little bit short. Hyatt tips it out. Roy kicking it out on the break to Dorsey quickly. Dorsey with a little spin. Tough to stop in that low block. It doesn't go. Now Yander's trying to push it the other way. Yander's all the way to the finger roll. Wow. Three fast breaks already in the game for Rob Yander's.
Rob Yander's straight into the heart of the Eagles' defense. I think you can see quite clearly what Coach Liebenhardt wants to do offensively here. Going to attack them right under the hoop.
Well, we've talked about Newcastle's defense. It's much easier if you beat them down court and they don't set up, as Dorsey hits for three.
Very good. First of all, we had Dorsey passing the ball to Babalola for a three. Now we've got Hyatt finding Dorsey for the three.
Well, we said there might be a few nerves. We've had 30 points in less than 5 minutes. Two teams filling it up here in the opening few minutes of the playoff final.
Showing that they deserve to be here, Dan.
Hampton with the head fake, force back out, shot clock running down. They've got to think about one to get it off. Julius Joseph.
Julius Joseph, interesting. Now four of the Rocks are already on the score sheet. Big battle inside, Daniel. You see that between Tony Dorsey and Sterling Davis.
Two veterans in the league, and Dorsey wants a foul as he goes in, gets the basket. No mistake about that.
Absolutely, and as if Sterling Davis doesn't look tough enough, he's got that mask on. He goes inside and pulls the foul down on Fab Flournoy.
Fab coming from the help side, trying to block him from behind. The referee saw a little piece of the arm there. So that'll be two free throws.
For those fans outside, Dan, watching Sterling Davis with that mask on his face, trying to protect a broken nose.
There's Coach Liebenhardt. He's had a pretty impressive debut season in the BBL.
Very, very much so. He's improved tremendously, especially if we remind the Rocks fans they started the season 0-3, and here they are in the last game of the season looking for a trophy.
Davis misses the first free throw.
It can't be easy, Daniel, playing with that mask all over his face there.
Even though it is see-through, just having it on your face does distract.
Especially if he starts to sweat and wipe and all that kind of stuff. But played a tremendous game yesterday in the victory over the BBL champion, Guildford Heat. It's the BBL
Championship Final. Fab Flournoy has been taking over the point guard duty since the trophy final, when TJ Walker, the standout point guard of the BBL over the last 5 or 6 years, broke his hand, finished his season. But Fab, it's funny, he started his career as a five-man, now he seems to be playing point guard.
Well, he will do whatever it takes, Daniel, whatever it takes. He handled the ball at the point, and he found himself under the basket scoring, and his defensive play allows Babalola now, looking for the bucket under the basket. Great effort.
Two easy ones for the Eagles, though. They didn't get it. Here's a fast break, 2-on-1. Hampton trying to draw the foul.
And who's got the rebound, Daniel?
Fab Flournoy, but more often than not in that situation, make the layup, don't worry about the foul.
Absolutely, absolutely. Oof, look at the effort.
Trying to keep that one alive. It went right through the hands of Babalola. Babalola looks to the referee and he says, it's not my fault, you lost it. Dorsey tried to save it, but he threw it off the back of the stanchion. So it'll be a Rocks ball. They lead by 4, 21-17. We play just over 6 minutes of the final game of the season.
Also, Daniel, a quick check out to see that the number of substitutions already this early in the game. Newcastle already have Andrew Bridge and Babalola in there. And now the Rocks got Gareth Murray in there and Hugo Sterk off the bench.
Sterk with the bounce pass to Davis. Shot clock down to three. Davis has to let it go. He does. It hits the ring. So reset of the clock. But Eagles come down with it to Andrew Bridge.
I think Fab Flournoy likes this unit on the floor because he knows he's going to get defense from these guys on the floor.
Babalola left open for three. We've already seen him hit one. They've left him open again to their pedal.
Back to back to back. We talked about the big men from the Rocks hitting three-pointers. We didn't expect the big guys for the Eagles to do the same.
One-point ball game now. 3 minutes to go in the first quarter.
You love to see that in a championship game. You don't want to see blowouts. You want to see these guys putting it all on the line.
Of course, it was a blowout last year when these two teams met.
That's right, of course, the same two teams in the playoff championship final. Fabulous Flournoy is really, really imposing himself.
Babalola again! Not this time.
Hustles, ooh.
Good hustle to chase after his own rebound. Got called for the foul, but Fab Flournoy will take that because at least he was going after it.
Absolutely, he'd like to see that from his young fella. This is a young fella already on the GB team, by the way, Daniel.
There's another young British guy coming into the game, Darius Defoe checking in.
I absolutely love Darius Defoe, Daniel. He's a guy who is so economical with the basketball. He's one of those players. He only touches the basketball to either block a shot or put the ball in the hoop.
Defoe leading the BBL in score and shooting percentages this year, shooting 60% from the floor. Doesn't tend to take them too far away, which is why he can shoot at 60%.
Exactly, and also he's a little bit of a sign to young English players out there. Not everybody has to go to college in America to come back and play at the highest level in this country.
Davis having his troubles from the free throw line today. Davis, that one just about rolls in for him.
Well balanced, this one.
It's a 2-point game. Lanois brings it over the halfway line for the Newcastle Eagles. They trail by two. Still in the first quarter. Flanoy trying to go all the way against Jones. It dumps inside. Good cut to the basket from Andrew Bridge. And Fab Flanoy found it.
I think we've seen that. You know, it's a tied ball game, Daniel. And Fab Flanoy has picked everybody up by the bootstraps and got them involved in the game.
Davis drives in. Great hands from Hyatt to knock it loose. Hyatt kicks it forward to Bridge. Bridge with the lay-in. And suddenly the Newcastle Eagles are in front.
Well, the Rocks are going to have to show the same fortitude they showed yesterday. They had a big lead and had to hold up the Guildford Heat. All of a sudden, they're into a dogfight right now.
Meanders has Joseph running the baseline. Decides against that. Now he's going to have to think about it. Shot clock down to three. Meanders kicks it out. Got to shoot. One on the shot clock as Murray gets it off. Rebounded by Bridge. Might have hit the ring. Doesn't matter.
Doesn't matter. They've got the ball now, the Eagles. Oh,
oh, wide open
this.
Underneath is Defoe, and that's, oh, he missed that one because he was fouled, but that's why he leads the league in poor shooting.
Absolutely.
Because he finishes it off close to the basket.
No messing around from Darius Defoe. He caught the ball, he turned around and went straight up to the basket. I'd love to see that. None of the showboating, none of the dribbling the ball all over the place. He's just trying to get the job done. Excellent young fella.
He might be a bit disappointed with himself that he didn't finish that play despite drawing the contact. One of them that you kind of think as a player, should only shoot one free throw here, not two.
And of course, the key is, there's a big fella that can make a free throw.
It's much easier to make one than two.
You're quite right,
there
mate.
We go.
Interesting, Daniel, that they've taken Robbie Anders off the point, the Rocks.
They do have enough people who can handle the ball. That's one advantage of the squad that Coach Leibniz has. He can rotate players through. Here's Hyatt. He loves this shot on the pull-up. Jeremy Hyatt guns his first three of the game, and he's not a guy you can let get hot.
No, he's key. I mean, he hit three back-to-back yesterday. I'm really surprised in the Rocks' defense, Daniel, that they're not going after Fab at the point position. I mean, he was able to dribble down the floor and pick out a pinpoint pass to Hyatt for the triple.
Good ball movement, wide open in the corner. Wallace, he's already hit one from down there. Didn't get that one to go.
This is the thing about three-point shooting, Daniel. If you don't make them, you've got long rebounds and you're in trouble.
Foul caught in there. I think it's on Fab Flanoy. We'll just check with the referee. He wanders over to the table. It is Fab. Team over the limit, so it'll be a long walk down for a couple of free throws.
Well, here's a critical point, Daniel. That's the third foul on Fab Flanoy.
And Fab's going to go sit down. But if there's one player in the league who can cope with foul trouble, it's this man right here, Fab Flanoy. But he'll be disappointed to have picked up three in the first quarter, no doubt about that.
You're right. As Tony Dorsey comes back and... whilst he wasn't necessarily able to carry the team through the first quarter, Fab has done that and put themselves in a good commanding lead.
This has been a very high scoring first quarter. In fact, we're 2 points away from the combined record. And if Newcastle get one more basket, it'll be the first time in a playoff final that anybody's got 30 points in the first quarter of a game.
Wow. Well done, Dan. I always knew you had all these numbers under your hat.
Dorsey fires up. Ooh. Dorsey with it. Whoa. 30 points in the first quarter.
Wow.
For the Newcastle Eagles, 52 ties the record for combined points in a quarter. It's been really high scoring.
Fantastic exhibition of basketball here for both teams.
Rocks trying to tick down for the final shot here of this period. Hugo Sturt driving in, dumps off, great pass, Joseph is fouled, and with 2.2 seconds to go, in the first quarter. Julius Joseph will go to the line shooting two.
You've got to credit Coach Leibniz and his team, you know, because irrespective of the situation down at the end of the first quarter, they just continue to play their game.
Julius Joseph makes the free throw, and this has been the highest scoring first quarter in the history of British basketball in the playoff final.
Absolutely fantastic.
Might get a Hail Mary. Dorsey throws it the length of that. You know, that wasn't too far up on line. It just didn't have enough legs. And at the end of the first quarter, it's been a record-breaking first quarter. 30 points to 23. The Eagles lead the Rocks. Scoring first quarter in history.
Well, I don't know if the Eagles can replicate that because they're on par for a 120-point game, Dan.
But the Eagles did set the record for a fourth quarter score against the Rocks last year, but we won't remind them of that. Funnily enough, Rocks held the record for a second quarter score from a couple of years ago. Dorsey lines up a three. That one's a bit short. Fighting for it. Oh, that looked like it came off Robinson from here. Referees are going to talk about it. Will Jones is going to run over and check Dale H. that he's sure about that. Referee says, my mistake, and they got it right in the end. That certainly looked from here as if Shawan Robinson tipped that one out of bounds.
Great to see the officials working together, Daniel. Fantastic that you know, they're able to get it right, and all we want is that they get it right.
Here's Maurice Hampton. Hampton drives in. A little bit too easy past Bridge. Bridge normally a good defender. Sterling Davis gives the Rocks a second chance opportunity here. He goes stuck through. Good ball movement. Hampton with the head fake. Steps under to the elbow for the jumper.
He had two different 6'9" guys jumping out in there and was able to knock it down. They've changed the defense now, Daniel, the Rocks.
To the 2-3 zone defense, just trying to throw Newcastle out of sync. Robinson driving into a little floater. And he's the sort of explosive guy that could have a big game in a final like this.
Oh, he'll hurt you in a hurry. I mean, he's been a little bit in and out of Coach Flournoy's rotation. But if you let him get rolling, you're going to pay for that.
Hampton. Driving through Stone. A little bit short. Dorsey pulls that one in. Kicks it out onto the
Oh, watch out.
He was trying to dunk it. He just lost his bearings for a second, but at least he got the 2 points. And out of nowhere, Newcastle now open up a 9-point lead here.
Just again, I must always say this every time Darius Defoe touches the ball, he simply touched the ball and put it in the basket. No wonder he's shooting over 60% from the field.
Davis, shot clock down for three. Davis finds a little gap.
Wow.
Babalola looks to the referee like, I got a foul there, but referee saying, look at the size of you. He's just going to barge you out of the way like that?
Talking about size, look at the size of Sterling Davis. His arms, he just hooked him there and went in for the layup.
Bridges three doesn't go. Tipped out by Davis to Hampton.
This is an important phase for the Rocks, Dan.
Can't afford to get too far behind.
Now, of course, they haven't got Yanders on the floor to direct traffic.
Start from a long way behind the off.
You've got to be confident if you're going to shoot one of those.
And when you're seven down, I don't think you need that shot. Robinson with a quick release three.
I don't think you need that either when you're nine up or seven up.
Murray back to Hampton, thought about it, comes back out.
The strength of the help defense from the Newcastle Eagles forcing the Rocks outside, Dan.
Taking a long time on their offenses as well here, the Rocks. They're down to six now to shoot.
There it goes.
Sturk fires it up. That one's long. Easy rebound for Babalola. One-handed it in. Bridge open for three.
Oof.
Andrew Bridge missed two
the
threes
Rocks,
already.
The Rocks really lucky there. The last two wide open three-point shots have rimmed out.
Yeah. And well, whilst the Rockets entertaining the crowd there, Torsten Liebeneck had plenty to say to his team in that timeout. I'm sure he'll just be wanting to get them to find some way of slowing down this Newcastle offense. 34 points is a lot of points to have given up in the ballgame already. Hampton driving to the hole. Great block from Babalola. Saves it, but only as far as Yanders. Yanders' shot doesn't go. And Newcastle just a bit slow to recover there, allowing extra chance opportunities for the Rocks.
The Rocks have missed a bunch of shots, Daniel, in the last 2-4 minutes. They've missed easy chippies. That was a short 10-foot jump shot for Yanders.
Hampton round the screen, wide open, guns it from about 18 feet.
Boy, did they need that.
Certainly did. Five-point game. Eagles with the ball. Robinson wide open for three, misses it. Wow. Bridge tipped it out of Aaron's hands, and it'll be Rock's ball from the end.
Robinson's missed both of his last three-point shots, and Fab Fonoy has checked himself back in. Remember, Fab's on three fouls.
Do you think it's a gamble, Vince? 6 minutes to go in the first half?
It's always a gamble, because also you're guarding some really quick players, and then Fab straight away has gone to mark Hampton, and Hampton went straight at him.
And the thing with Fab is it doesn't matter if he's on three fouls, he's going to play defense the same.
He only knows one way to play, and that's 100%.
Babalola with the pull-up, tough shot with the hand in his face from Wallace, right in front of him.
It's a seven-point game, and the Rocks need someone to light a fire for them.
Wallace trying in the low post off the glass.
Gets that one to go.
Flannoy hands over to Babalola and gets it back again. Dorsey in the paint wants it. He gets it. Great help.
Great
defense.
Help defense.
Three-on-one break. And Fab is the one. He can't afford to foul. Oh! Davis throws it off the back of the ring, but fortunately for him, the Rocks keep possession. Oh, big shot from Anrin.
That might be the fire being lit right there. A two-point ball game.
It's his first real contribution to the game, Anrin.
Yeah, he checked in that timeout, and yesterday had two or three triples.
Babalola's three doesn't go.
They're on the run again. They're on the run again.
To tie, maybe even take the lead. That's a travel. Hampton going one way, coming back the other. It's an NCAA travel. In the NCAA, you'd probably get another step after that too if you were at home.
Especially if you're playing number 23.
Yeah, it's true. Are we getting a sub here? There's a pause in the game like we're getting a sub, but
looks like Makoto's coming in.
And Bridge is going to sit down. The problem is, Fab Flannoy is the player coach. He's shouting, come in. Makoto doesn't know who he's coming in for.
He's listening to the coach, the assistant coach, the referees, and the table. Interesting, Makoto's coming. I'm not happy the way they're allowing Fab to just take his time bringing the ball up. Now Makoto's coming, and surely he's not going to play the two spot.
Looks like he is on his opening play at least. Hyatt for three off the mark. Made that early one. Hasn't made one since. Yanders with a little pull up, just shy of the foul line. Fab Flannoy with the rebound. Flannoy still going. Kicks it out to Hyatt. Hyatt drives in, nice dish back to Dorsey. Dorsey off the glass, doesn't go. And there's a foul in there on Maurice Wallace.
Dorsey's going to go to the free throw line. You've got to keep him off the line if you're going to contain him.
Well, we talk about how high scoring it is. These are actually two of the stingiest teams in the league. Second and third in terms of points against per game. Dorsey, no mistake with the first free throw.
That's right, and if you send a guy like this to the line 9-10 times, you know, he's going to end up on 30 points by the time he's finished.
Well, I mentioned that game in 2000. He was 16 of 19 from the free throw line on that occasion. Missed that one. He's into double digits, though, with 10. Leads all scorers. And here come the Rocks, trailing by a basket. Inside to Davis. Great spin from Davis. Babalola had a swipe at him. Lucky not to get away with the foul there. Strong, Davis lays it in.
Strong inside from Davis.
Davis into double digits now as well. Inside to Dorsey. Dorsey with that trademark little fall away. They usually go for Tony Dorsey. That one didn't. Yanders. That's the fourth time this game he's beaten the Eagles defense down the floor.
And Fabulous almost went for the block shot and decided he didn't want to get onto four fouls with 3 minutes to go in quarter number two.
And again, there's good recognition from Yanders knowing that to attack him.
Absolutely.
Good pass. Great pass. Fab Flannoy finding Babalola. Easy lay-in. Sloppy foul.
Sloppy foul, Daniel. You either knock the fella down or you let him have it.
Wallace did neither. I remember when I was growing up as a kid, I was always told, if you're going to foul him, foul him. Don't drop, let him lay it in like that.
Drop the hammer, as they say. Babalola has been really big for them here.
He's up to 11 now, Babalola. He now leads all scorers.
Good job he showed up.
Eagles leading the Rocks by two here in the 2007 playoff final. Sterling Davis. Oof.
Sterling Davis is going to make sure the Rocks are going to stay in contention, you know. Tying the ball game.
Tying. Inside to Dorsey. Dorsey trying to spin. Almost stolen by Yanders. Flannoy kept it though. Babalola thought about the three, decided against it, took it inside. Tried to bounce that in.
Did that come
in
off somebody's foot?
I must admit, it looked like it should have been an Eagles ball. Fab Flannoy's arguing that. Interestingly, it was Will Jones on the baseline who made that call. Dale Aitchison up top didn't overrule him, even though Dale had been overruled on one by Will Jones. We're level up 40, less than three to go in the first half. Hampton drives in, good dish, but well read by Hyatt.
Hyatt's done a lot of that today. Oh, look at this!
No call! Oh! No call at Hampton! Dorsey runs over Yanders, no call, and there's a little reach round by Hampton.
Oh,
and
I'm Coach sorry,
Coach Leibniz is going crazy. He's like, well, how do you get a reach round call there and nothing at the halfway line?
My goodness me, oh dear, oh dear. Oh, you hate to see a blatant mistake like that.
He's not a happy man, is he? He is not a happy man.
I don't blame the fella. Dorsey caught that ball and went forward. Yanders was waiting a long time for him. It wasn't one of those whereby he didn't give him space to stop. Difficult, difficult. If they score from here, that's a big turnaround. Oh,
oh, and they get a three as well. Rub salt in the wounds.
That could have been a six-point turnaround. The Rocks don't get an offense going the other way, and they come down and hit a three. And Tony Dorsey now only has the one foul. Oh, hope he doesn't come back to bite them.
14 for Babalola. Yanders trying to reply for three. Comes all the way out to Joseph off the back of the ring. Joseph driving in tough. Gets nothing to go though. Dorsey with the ball. Eagles on the break. Bridge. Bridge trying to flip one up. Looks to the referee for some help. Gets none. Doesn't deserve any either. Yanders.
Robert Yanders.
In at the foul line, a bit short.
He's missed three of those short jumpers there, Daniel. They need those to go down.
He needs to keep taking it to the basket. That's when he's been.
He's got it again. Oh, beautiful ahead pass there.
It was a bit far ahead of Hampton, but Flannoy was the man chasing back.
He was never going to go for that block.
Nope. Fab Flannoy is normally a great shot blocker. He's fifth in the league, in fact, but on three fouls in the first half of the playoff final, he's not going after that one.
I think that was Julius, that one.
Yeah, and Andrew Bridge knew about it. As they say, Julius Joseph got his money's worth out of that foul.
Good to see. I was getting a bit worried this season, Daniel. You know, you've got to be allowed to foul hard, and you watch the NBA time and again, you're allowed to foul hard as long as you're going for the ball.
Babalola again, guns yet another three.
Is that four?
17 big points for Olu Babalola.
Wow.
It is his fourth three-pointer of the game. I think he's four of six.
Wow, big plays for the Eagles.
Davis driving. He's stolen away by Dorsey. Eagles on the run to Bridge. Yanders is back to knock it loose, but he can only knock it out of bounds. And with 50 seconds to go in the first half, we're going to get a timeout call. And Jeremy Hyatt gets ready to receive the ball from the official to lob into Tony Dorsey. This is Dorsey's spot. Watch for a little turnaround ball away. Here it is.
Oh, we got a foul call on this one. It might be on Wallace. Did he reach in?
Yep.
He did. Oh, he's on three.
They're going to take him right out of the game.
He was explosive in the first quarter last night, Daniel, and he hasn't really did it up today.
Hit that early three in the corner. He's missed a few from down there since. And
that's
a couple
right.
of post moves as well, which really, for a guy so big, he doesn't really go on the block enough for my liking.
No, and I think that's where you talk about this European style of basketball. Yeah. You know, Coach Leibniz will counter that by saying, well, he can bring his big man outside and maybe pay some dividends.
He certainly can shoot the three ball, no mistaking that. Dorsey, there's one of two from the line yet again.
I'm surprised Fab hasn't taken himself out there with just about 40 seconds to go. You don't want to pick up your fourth foul trying to jump all over Sterling Davis.
Yanders has it for the Rocks. 30 seconds to go in the first quarter. Did anybody touch that?
Nope.
No, it's a backcourt.
Backcourt violation.
Just wondered whether Bridge might have got a little finger on that. The referee said no, and it gives Newcastle the ball back. Just over an offense left, 27 seconds. So there is a possibility the Rocks will get one back, but they won't have much time if they do.
No, and all of a sudden, where we were thinking Coach Lieberknecht might be able to take a deep breath when he gets in the locker room, he's got
Could
to be a little mad now.
He's higher. Trying to post up. Hampton's pushed him a long way from home. Shot clock down to six. Hyatt dumps it off. Oh, good steal. Davis might have got away with a little walk.
And a travel and a little double dribble.
Yanders with the lay-in. Perfect finish to the first half by the Scottish Rocks. And what a first half we've had. An explosive opening period, breaking records in scoring. The second quarter has been a lot tighter. But at the half, it's the Newcastle Eagles 47. The Scottish Rocks 44. Welcome back to Newcastle. It's the final game of the British basketball season, the BBL Championship Playoff Final. I'm Daniel Routledge, and with me, Vince McCauley. Vince, you said at the top of the game you had a sneaky feeling for Newcastle. Halftime, they're up four. Do you still feel that way? Up three, sorry. Do you still feel that way?
Well, yes. I looked at my calculations, and I had Newcastle winning this game by one. Championship games hopefully will go down to the decider, and right now nothing has changed my mind.
Hyatt trying to get over Hampton. He crushes Sivan. Hyatt looks in trouble. Meanwhile, Rocks run the other way. Hyatt just getting back to his feet. The three for Hampton. Hyatt is limping. He's waving at the bench. Referee's going to stop it. And Jeremy Hyatt is going to hobble out of this game. Now, the key thing is both his knees are already strapped up. So he obviously has problems in that area. Tendon problems, probably. Is that an impact injury, i.e. in 2 or 3 minutes he'll be all right? Or is that something more serious? Because they're going to need him for the remaining 19 and a half minutes here.
Well, we're going to have to find out very shortly. I mean, it's one of those things, if there was a pop or if it was just a case of a little bit of pain on his tendon, the crucial thing is that happened, and then the Rocks have gone down the floor and hit a three-pointer, and we have a tied ball game.
Robinson driving through Joseph with a look of disbelief on his face, but the foul is called on him.
Well, Joseph's not the most athletic of players in the BBL, and I'm not sure trying to block that shot from behind will be what the doctor ordered.
There's Jeremy. He doesn't look too bad now, does he? So maybe it was just an impact thing.
Well,
they're not working too hard on his knee, although there is some concern over there.
He's not normally the happiest looking of characters unless he's got a trophy in his hand, so difficult to tell.
Robinson gets Newcastle's first points of the second half. 2-point Eagles lead.
The Eagles have had 24 points off the bench, Daniel, against three for the Rocks, and that could be a major stat come the end of the game.
Although of those 24, 17 have been Olu Babalola, who went 4 of 6 from behind the arc in the first half. Here's Bridge trying to add some more points off the bench, but his three won't go.
Well, I wonder how long before Babalola gets into the game. He's a fairly fit-looking young fella. I don't think he's going to be fazed about running up and down the floor for a bunch of minutes. They may need him in the game.
Good little block there from Sherlock as Yanders went to the basket. Inside to Dorsey. Joseph had a piece of his arm. You can wave that score off. The foul is going to be called on Julius Joseph. I make that his third.
Well, I'm not sure Joseph can guard Dorsey any day of the week, so that was a mismatch situation right there, which the Eagles exploited. That's, I believe, three fouls?
It is his third, yes. And he's going to go down to the bench with Hugo Sterk checking in for him.
I like Hugo Sterk, Daniel. Extremely athletic young fella, full of bags of confidence. If he can get himself going, that might be someone that could help Yanders take this team forward.
Dorsey. Spinning, trying to go to work on Davis. What a matchup that is, and what a finish by Dorsey. All sorts of contact, no problems for Tony Dorsey. Sanders taking his time. Gets it back from Murray. Off of the screen. Goes around it. Double screen, in fact.
Interesting, Coach. Lieberknecht chose to leave Wallers on the bench on three fouls to start this second half.
Meanders doesn't go. That might come all the way out to Sturkey. Didn't get the bounce of the ball. Robinson has it. Robinson kicks out. Sherlock fakes at it in the corner. Back out to Flannoy. Flannoy trying to find Bridge on the weak side. Great vision from Flannoy. And it's tipped in by Tom Sherlock.
That's what Tom Sherlock does. Runs around, makes himself a nuisance on defense, and hangs around the basket offensively.
Ooh, Robinson almost got a piece of that. Back to Gareth Murray. Head fake, drives in, dumps off to Davis. Great play from Gareth Murray to feed Sterling Davis.
Love to see the young fella, Dan. There's a guy who's had experience from the Commonwealth Games to Scotland. I'm really, really coming to his own this season.
Robinson knocked loose by Yanders, but foul is called. There's a couple of really aggressive matchups going on right now. Dorsey and Davis, and Robinson and Yanders really going at it.
Fantastic to see, and nice to see Dorsey there. He knew that Robinson had the mismatch with the smaller Yanders, and he was determined to get it for him.
There's Hyatt. Like you say, it's hard to tell. He doesn't look very happy, though. They're not working on the knee. That's the interesting thing. I don't know whether that means he's done for the night, so they've given up working on it, or he'll be okay. We shall wait and see. I think he's just gone like that underneath, which would lead me to believe that Jeremy Hyatt is not coming back in the game. I think he's just signaled that to the assistant coach, Billy Spragg.
Interesting. Interesting.
We'll keep an eye on it, but certainly the signal he just made to Billy Spragg made it look like he wasn't coming back into the game.
The Rocks need to get something going here. They've dropped down 6 points.
Long shot. Oh, deep three for Rob Yanders.
Robert Yanders, tough customer. Here we go with that matchup you were talking about, Daniel.
Dorsey trying to back down. Davis, stolen away by Hampton.
2-on-1, he hasn't seen
Yanders.
Him.
He has now. Bridge is back. Good D, is it? It was a very late whistle.
Wow.
From referee Will Jones. The hand went up before the whistle was blown. I think he was waiting for the referee on the other side to make the call, and when he saw he wasn't going to do that, Will Jones decided, I'll make that call then.
I would have liked to have seen Yanders pop back over the top of Bridge for Hampton, because he was racing along there, could have got a layup. Anyway, Yanners is pretty much money from the free throw line.
He certainly is. Babalola, now is the time that he comes into the game. 3 minutes, 20 seconds into the second half. Olu Babalola, who is the game's leading scorer with 17 first half points, checks in while Rob Yanders shoots a pair of free throws.
The Rocks were woeful in the first half from the free throw line, Daniel. 5 out of 12. Missed 7 chippies, and they don't need to address that fact here.
Which is really weird, because the Rocks have led the league in free throw shooting this season. They've led the league in 3-point shooting, and they've been pretty high up in field shooting. So they're a good shooting team.
Well, it is a championship final, and we thought those early buckets could have calmed the nerves. Ooh.
See, there again, Yanders and Robinson. Really is another aggressive matchup. Great hands to knock it loose. There's an outlet pass to Hampton. Hampton did well to keep it in bounds, but only to Flannoy. Play broken a bit. Bridge to Dorsey. Dorsey trying to dump it in.
Oh, excellent Yanders defensive effort.
Diving back. Cameraman taking one for the team there.
At least we got it right down the pipe. Robert Yanders racing the length of the court. Wow. Credit to Yanders.
Credit to the cameraman, too. Good job that was Rob Yanders and not somebody bigger.
Sterling Davis would have had the end of that shot from there. Well, Babalola's back where he started, knocks that one down.
Word is from the Eagles bench that Hyatt might come back in the game. He's not ruled it out yet, but he is struggling. I'm sure if they need him down the stretch, he'll be out there.
I get the impression when Fab gets out there in a timeout, he'll have a word with him.
That's true. If Fab tells you you're back on court, you're back on court. Bridge in the corner for three. Ooh. Finally knocks one down.
You said you can't sleep on Andrew Bridge. You were right.
He's missed a few today. He had to make one eventually. A shooter that good doesn't miss that many.
There's a lot of contact going on, Daniel. all these picks.
Hampton driving in, flips it up, and it's good to see in a game like this, let the players win it. Don't call too many ticky-tack
fouls. You do want to see that. Let players decide the games. Oh! That's been called on Sterling Davis, I think. Oof.
Third foul on Sterling.
Oh, it's a big foul. He's going to have to sit down.
Wallace is also on three fouls. He's going to check into the game. And Robinson, once again, will go to the free throw line.
I didn't think he was going anywhere on that drive. Now he's going to make him pay. Yep, he's made him pay.
4 points for him from the line in this quarter, 8 in total. Yanders. Forced back out by Bridge.
Well, those two would have played together at Sheffield, wouldn't they, Daniel? Yanders and Bridge?
Certainly would have. Dorsey fighting with it. Who'd it touch last? Referee points towards Hugo Sturck.
Yeah,
and said it came
legs.
Off you. And therefore, it'll be an Eagles ball.
Rucks haven't quite had the right bounce of the ball so far.
Now, there's been a few of those 50-50 ones that have just gone away from them. Robinson. Babalola off the screen. Robinson turns the corner, Ooh. Fires it up. Oh, it almost went in. It's a bit of a prayer shot, but it almost went in. 3-on-3 break. Hampton drives alone. He kicks it out.
Who's that on?
I think it might be on Bridge.
Oof, save Fab from moving on to four fouls there.
It is on Andrew Bridge.
Good to see the Rocks are still attacking the middle, though.
Here's a weird thing, though. Hampton goes through. He's in the air. He's above Bridge. What did he pass it for? Even when you hear the whistle, just throw it up.
Throw it up.
Get
yep.
two free throws instead of an end line ball. 4:26 to go in the third quarter. Eagles lead the Rocks 62-56. The Eagles enjoyed the lion's share of the lead, but the Rocks have never been out of it.
Oh,
Babalola.
Babalola put that one up.
He stands there with his arms up in the air. The thing players have a habit of doing is hands go up in the air. When the shot goes, it goes forward for the foul, and then it goes right back to straight up in the air. Look, ref, my arms are straight up in the air, honest.
Yeah. Oh, dear. It wasn't me. Well, Wallace is going to have to come to play because Sterling Davis is anchored to the bench.
And unlike Fab, I don't think Torsten's going to gamble with Davis just yet. I think he'll leave it probably till the fourth quarter before we see Sterling Davis, unless it gets too far away.
Well, it's a 5-point game right now. Oh, look at this.
Bridge. Oh, he should have made that. Dorsey bails him out by getting the offensive rebound. Dorsey going back to work. Bridge this time tips it out. Back into Dorsey. Dorsey going to work. Kicks it out. Robinson. Babalola. Robinson for three. Beautiful offense by the Eagles, and Shawan Robinson finishes it off with a triple.
Credit Robinson there, Daniel. He was the one right in the key there trying to score before he found Babalola and found some space outside and was there when the big fella needed him.
Yanders around the screen.
This Yanders. One's up.
For two, long two from Rob Yanders. Just had his feet straddling the line.
You know what, Yanders may have to take a little bit more on his shoulders here because the rest of his team are struggling. Hampton's nowhere to be seen. Murray is really phased a little bit here, so I think Yanders is going to have to step up here. Liberneth may as well be playing. He's on the court there practically, Dan.
He's running defensive slides over on the far side. Bridge for three again. Yes, he gets the roll.
Oh, Andrew Bridge is killing him.
Andrew Bridge with a home court roll there. That one bubbled up and over. And you just get the feeling that this next 3 minutes could be very decisive in the destination of this final because the Eagles, with Davis on the bench on three fouls, are starting to take advantage here.
Well, it's 9 points. You wondered how long Davis was going to be sitting down. Coach Liebenath has seen enough. I think Davis is going to come back, and I think they're going to change their defense from that floppy zone because they just allowed the Eagles to come in there and set the tone.
Certainly have. This is where the coaches make their money. A, spotting the run in time to stop it, which I think Coach Lebenick did there. He just spotted it in time and said, hang on a minute, it's got out to 9. Let's stop this and do something about it. And now he's got a minute to do something about it. You're tipping a defensive change. I wouldn't disagree with you there. I think they need to do something defensively a bit differently. But offensively, they don't seem to be able to get down the court as quick as they were doing in the first half.
No, you're quite right there, Dan. And also, the problem with this style of play that the Rocks sort of employ is basically if you don't make these shots and you're playing against a team that's going to pick up the rebounds, you know, you're really playing into their hands.
Well, as the Rockets finish their routine, the team's wander back out onto court, but Sterling Davis is not amongst them.
No, he's still
on
the bench.
Thought he might gamble there, Coach Liebenack, put him out.
It's a nine-point deficit with 3 minutes to go in the third, Dan. I don't know how long he can afford to wait. If the Rocks don't reduce the deficit on this play, the Eagles could push the thing out to 12 points, double figures.
I think if the Rocks don't score and the Eagles do on the next two plays, we'll see Sterling Davis into the game. And we're driving to the hole. Ooh.
Got the foul on Robinson, huh?
Might even be on Defoe in there, is it? No, it is Robinson. You were right.
Anrin finally going to the hole. He's a big fella. He hasn't been to the hole yet.
But he didn't finish with any great strength on that last one, though.
No, he's one of those guys who wants to shoot it from outside. Obviously, he's done well having joined the team late in the season and tried to mesh himself into what the coach has been doing with his players.
Yeah, it can be difficult to join a team, especially a team that's been doing quite well late on in. There's Ian Reid and his wife cheering on the Rocks. They're always there following them around.
As passionate a set of fans as you're going to see for the Rocks there.
Yes, yes indeed.
That defense has changed, Daniel. They've gone to a 1-3-1 zone.
They needed to do something different,
they did,
that's for
they
sure.
Did.
Robinson, great pass to Defoe. That's the only problem with a 1-3-1 is you can get caught out the back. They get away with it on that occasion with a defensive rebound.
Well, Coach Liebenath will chalk that one up to a great change there and great effort by his team.
Hampton trying to turn the corner. Ooh. Gets it out to Yanders. Yanders lines up a three, a little bit short.
There you go. There's that shot from outside and no rebounders.
Bridge dumps to Flannoy. Back out Babalola again, not this time. Defoe with the rebound. Block. Great block it is too by Wallace.
Coach Liebenath is begging for a foul in there. He thinks his men are being slapped around.
Hampton under pressure kicks it out to Murray and Rocks reset for Yanders.
Well, if they get this one to go, it'll be a successful timeout for Coach Liebenath. Ooh,
good head
Murray.
Oh, in and out from Murray and Defoe.
No rebounders for the Rocks. Four Eagles around the ball.
And yet you look at the height of the team. Look across the middle of the defense. They've got 3-6-9 guys out there.
Well, they're all camping on the three-point line. The referee doesn't buy that flop.
Yeah, a bit of a flop from Hampton.
Almost there you go.
Not quite by Murray. Flannoy gets it back. Flannoy drives through. Bridge open for three.
It's off.
Doesn't get the roll this time.
Great hand. Oh, look at that. Excellent hands, Hampton.
He was on the baseline. That was his only problem. He knocked the ball away, but as he caught it, he was lying out of bounds.
Great spirit this game has been played in. Babalola picking Hampton off the floor there. Nice to see at this. You know these guys want to win.
Here comes Davis. Minute and five to go in the third quarter. Sterling Davis walks back out on court, sorting out his mask to put on.
again, coaches have this dilemma. You know, you want to get Davis back in the game. You've ridden it a little bit long, but now you bring him in with a minute to go in the third. You don't want him to pick up a foul here.
Robinson's three doesn't go.
Look.
You see? And how much is that to do with the fact that Davis is a little worried?
That's right. That's right. You know, Defoe does what he does best again.
Wallace down on the block, trying to go to work against the post. Stolen away by Babalola.
Watch out.
Oh my goodness!
Tried
special double pump reverse stuff.
Oh no.
And threw it over the ring. Just dunk it.
He's going to be in for a roasting when.
He almost got another chance. Davis gets him up.
Oh my.
With that two missed dunks.
Two missed dunks, one from either side. Fab is not going to be happy about that one.
Babalola to make up for three. No, Wallace pulls in the lead now.
9 points to still the deficit.
10 seconds to go here in the third quarter. Yanders looks up at the clock, down to four. Yanders drives in, kicks
beautiful
out, got a
pass.
shoot on the buzzer for three. Doesn't go. And we've reached the end of the third quarter, and still the Newcastle Eagles leading this ball game here. At the end of three, it's the Eagles, 70 points. The Scottish Rocks, 61. Newcastle Eagles, who last year won all four trophies, they've lost three of them. Can they hang on to the fourth here in the playoff final and repeat last year's win over the Scottish Rocks? Hampton inside with a good score. They just won the Rocks for a 1-0.
That's right, Daniel. Coach Lehman has got to target Flo Noh. He's on three fouls. He's the one who plays the ball. The best defense, I was going to say, of the Eagles. They've got to capitalize, but then he's thrown it away.
But here's the thing. When did Fab pick up that third foul?
Yep, you're quite right, in the first quarter.
It was a long time ago in the first quarter. And he's got this far in the game without committing another, and he hasn't spent too much time on the bench. Hampton going to the hole again. Flo Noh there to pressure him. Dorsey slips, but Flo Noh picks it up.
I think significantly, Daniel, as we
watch. Big shot! Big shot for Robinson for three in the corner! And it's a 10-point Eagles lead.
I was going to say, Danny, I think significantly Olu Babalola started this quarter on the bench. I don't think Fab liked the fact that he tried to reverse dunk the basketball instead of just dunking it the regular fashion. Sterling Davis knocking everybody over, goes to the hole and gets the call. It's on Fab.
And there we go. We've just been talking about it. And there is foul number four. Do you think he's going to take himself out of the game?
No, I don't think he's going to take himself out of the game.
Neither do I.
He's got a situation here. You know, he's only now, with the injury to Jeremy Hyatt on the bench, he's only got Babalola and Sherlock to come in. He's having a long think about it.
We did see a few minutes from Makota as well, but certainly Babalola would be the one you would have thought, given the first half he had, although that dunk was probably the low light of his third quarter.
Yes, I mean, I don't think this is a Makota kind of game, really.
No.
I think Fab's going to try and ride this.
Oh. Tell you what, you can't miss free throws at any stage in the season, but with less than 9 minutes to go in the playoff final, you really can't afford to be missing free throws the way the Rocks have today.
Nope, they've stuck with their 1-3-1 zone. And Bridge, oof.
Well, he got one really kind roll earlier. He didn't get that one there.
No, but both shots, the three-point shots for the Eagles against this defense has come on the right-hand side corner three-point line. But somebody's got to give Yanders a hand here. You know, disappointed in Julius Joseph, disappointed in Werlers.
Shot clock's down to four. I don't think Yanders sees it. Yanders has got to shoot it. Gets it off just in time.
You know, Yanders has got to see Andrew Bridge and know that he can go by him anytime he likes. You know, and he's really going to have to step up.
Dorsey on the block. Stepping on, what a play from Tony Dorsey for two.
That's the thing, you see, when you can always give the ball to a multiple champion down low to get the job done. The Rocks aren't able to do that at the moment.
Hampton.
Oh.
To Davis. Davis under pressure.
A little bit too much on it from Davis.
They've missed a few too many easy ones today, the Rocks.
I think the Rocks...
the score for the foul.
That's number four. The Rocks are in trouble, Daniel.
Yep. Here comes Olu Babalola, and he's going to give Defoe a breather. Yeah, you just get the feeling right now the Rocks are starting to sway. They need something to get that second wind, whether it be a dunk on the break or a three-point shot or a block shot. They need a spark play.
Well, what you got is their three guards on now with the foul on Joseph. Their three guards are on. They might be able to give him something here. Yeah, here you go.
Yanders with the steal. Flo Noh is quickest to it.
Oh,
good
my,
ball
the
movement.
Same spot.
Oh.
That's now they've got to run.
in that 1-3-1. You can get lost on the baseline all the way out to the three-point line. You can hide. Rawlings.
Oh, look at this.
Stoke keeps it inbounds. Yanders.
Yanders. Oh, look, they put Babalola on Yanders.
Davis. Davis can't convert. Wallace with the stick back. They needed that. They needed that.
I'm not sure what defense the Eagles are in there because they're trying to hide Fab on his four fouls. There's no way he could have been guarding Davis on four fouls.
No. Still an eight-point Eagles lead. 6:40 to go. Illinois to Bridge. There's that gap again.
The same gap.
And that's the problem with the 1-3-1. That is the weak spot. If you've got people who can make anything from a 10-foot all the way out to a three-point line shot along the baseline, that is where it is. Hampton inside to Davis, out to Wallace. Good hands from Babalola. And
Wallace
just thinking timeout, and Coach Labanek turns to the bench and signals for one.
Yep. Oh.
Bridge. Oh, he should have scored.
It's 10 points. The rocks are all over the place.
You go Stark in and out. Rebound Dorsey.
This is what I was saying about jump shots, Daniel. Just jump shots, and just more jump shots.
And this is starting to look a little bit like the final of last year where Newcastle just ground them down in the second half. And there's another tough shot from Olu Babalola.
Has he come up limping? Has
he come up limping?
Yeah, the difficulty here now, down with a 12-point lead, the Eagles can milk the clock and take their time and pick them to pieces.
Well, this is probably the most important timeout of the season for the Scottish Rocks. They need to come out of here with some momentum. They need to come out with some stops and some scores just to get themselves back within touching distance more than anything else. What do you think, Vince? They come out in a man-to-man, or they need to change the D somehow?
They need to change it. I certainly need to get out of that 1-3-1 right now because the Eagles have quickly picked the holes in that. I think they're probably going to have to come out in a man-to-man, even though that's not going to favor them because they're going to be undermanned physically. But I think offensively now, with the three guards on there, I think Coach's got to ask Robert Yanders to go out there and get effective and let Hugo Sturck and Hampton be the guys chasing back, trying to stop any Eagles' fast breaks.
Well, we'll see. Certainly Julius Joseph is coming back into the game now for the Rocks.
Well, it looks like maybe Sturck has shot his load yesterday because he hasn't given us anything today. He's a very, very athletic young man. But, you know, against this Eagles team, who themselves are a bunch of athletes, that's been nullified.
Yeah, Hugo Sturck with the goose egg next to his name. No points in the ball game. Here we go, then. Last 5.5 minutes of the season. And if the Rocks are not to end up just as they did 12 months ago on the wrong end of a defeat to the Newcastle Eagles in the playoff final, they need to do something quickly. Hampton.
There we go.
Beautiful backdoor dish from Wallace.
There's the bit of the quickness that Hampton brings to the game. Now they need a stop. They've gone to the man-to-man, Daniel.
You don't need to be a coach, really, to have picked that one. And I'm certainly not a coach. Hampton is called for the foul. Had to do something defensively, and the logic was go to man-to-man.
Yeah, they had to do that, and I just hope that that sojourn in those zones hasn't cost them an opportunity to be in contention down the stretch.
That's still a big foul, though. Fourth foul on Maurice Hampton, so him and Joseph both on four. Flannoy the other way is on four. Here's Fab Flannoy trying to go to work on Hampton. Oh, is that on Hampton?
He's
run
he's
in
gone.
There. Let's wait and see. 21 is the signal, and Mo Hampton's just fouled out of the ball game. Oh, what a blow. Oh, no, that's his fourth. My mistake. They had four up on the scoreboard previously. They put four up again.
Well, Coach Liebenathel, thank you for that then.
Yeah.
Oh, Andrew Bridge has killed these guys today. Andrew Bridge, I know Fabulous Flannoy is very, very high on this young Englishman. Plays defense the way he wants him to and does exactly what he asks him to on the offensive end. 14 points.
And 10 of them coming in the second half. And in 15 minutes, he's got 10 points. That's big off the bench, not to mention the defense that he plays.
That's right. I'm disappointed. Sterling Davis hasn't touched the ball on this offense. Disappointing.
He's the guy they need to go to. They need to go to Davis, Hampton, and Yanders, really. Well, Joseph hasn't really done it tonight.
Yesterday we had a similar situation where Michael Martin disappeared in the second half of the game, and the same is happening here to Sterling Davis. Watching
we were talking about Bridge and his 14 points, 10 in the second half. Davis also has 14, 2 in the second half. Fab Lenoir driving to the hole.
You see, there's the inspirational play from Fab. That all that does is make his teammates work harder and play harder. There's their coach. Not only is he coaching them, he's playing for them. He's on four fouls and he's scoring for them.
Yander's driving in, little high floater.
We gotta see this. If I'm Coach Liebenhardt, I'm going to Rob. I'm saying, Rob, go to the basket, and you big fellas, go get the rebound.
Dorsey spinning. Dorsey off the back of the ring. There's a foul in there somewhere.
That's
that one's on Hampton, and this time it is his fifth and final foul. And you wonder now where in these last 4 minutes with Hampton, who's got 16 points to his name, where are they going to get the offense to overcome 12 points now, the Rocks?
Well, as we watch him go off, it's going to have to come from Hugo Sterk. Hampton's done a terrific job as best he can in this game. He was just beginning to heat up. You know, instead of that, we've sent the man to the free throw line to put the icing on the cake.
Tony Dorsey, no mistake with the first. Of course, three-time MVP in the championship final. Fails to get the second. Unusually wayward with his free throw shooting today, though.
Well, we talked earlier, Daniel, about who was going to light the fire for the Scottish Rocks. I think the answer was nobody.
Yeah.
Because Rob Yanders is not going to be able to carry this team on his own. Julius Joseph has been MIA, and Sterling Davis has shut it down.
Davis, in fairness to him, got in foul trouble, so that's part of the problem. Olu Babalola to the hole, 23 points. He's got to be in the running for MVP, but will he finish the game the way he's hobbled back down court?
Again, Davis didn't take advantage. He should have just gone to the hole.
This is the thing, Babalola is barely able to move.
Yeah, I think
he can't go laterally, that's for sure.
Fab Fleury is going to have to think about taking him out.
3:24 left in the ball game, 86-71. The Eagles lead the Rocks, and another timeout to the Scottish Rocks.
Well, the Eagles
really
bench,
the last chance
absolutely, Danny. The Eagles bench are high-fiving themselves and everything. They think the job is done. The Scottish Rocks are showing a little bit of sympathy and looking for forgiveness. But you know, at the end of the day, it's the last game of the season. There's 3.5 minutes to play. What are you saving it for? There's nothing left.
It's a long, long summer to recover, that's for sure. Give it everything you've got in these last 3.5. But like you, I'm just wondering where it's going to come from. Rob Yanders has been really the main man for the Rocks. He's had a little bit of help from Hampton, but Hampton's done now. And you just can't see where the rest of it's going to come from.
Exactly, and you hate to know what the numbers are from the bench. I mean, I'm sure it's going to be a phenomenal lopsided number in terms of what these Eagles have been able to get off their bench, especially in the shape of Olu Babalola versus the Scottish Rocks, who I think, you know, Coach Liebenhardt may have more points from the bench himself.
Well, I mean, you just look down, you talk about it. Bridge, 14 points off the bench. Babalola, 23 points off the bench. So there you've got two guys who've given you almost half your offense off the bench.
Yes, it's a tough one. I mean, it's difficult to see that because the Rocks coming into this game have won 10 in a row, including beating the Eagles in that stretch. So, you know, so you felt they had the winning feeling. But I was watching the way they celebrated yesterday after they defeated the Guildford Heat. They looked like they'd won the championship yesterday. And maybe that little bit of focus was lost.
It's knocked out of bounds by Olu Babalola. Yeah, the Rocks really were the form team coming into this weekend. They were the team, they might have been the lowest seed, but they had the best record coming in.
That's
in the
right.
Last few weeks of the season.
I think quite importantly, they'd beaten every single other team that was here. So, you know, here we go to Davis, and it just might be a little too late. You know, either you go to Yanders from the get-go or you go to Davis straight away.
Well, it was 83-68 in the final last year when these two teams met. So it was a pretty comfortable 15-point win. It's on course for something similar like that this time around, unless the Rocks can do something in the last 3 minutes.
Well, it's a 13-point deficit, and the Eagles have the ball. We've got Dorsey and Davis trying to join the WWF here. I think Davis is going to come off worse for wear in a second.
Dorsey trying to throw it cross-court, stolen away by Yanders, knocked loose by Bridge. Yanders is first to it.
No
Dorsey
call.
Gets another one away with another one at the half court. And here's just a thing, just a little point, going back to earlier when Hampton kicked it out. Yanders heard the whistle, he threw it up, hit the bottom of the ring.
Exactly.
He knows if he throws it up, he's got a chance of two shots.
All young fellas watching that, you know, you're attacking the basket, put it up there. You know, I think the referees are, yes, they have given it to him. They're going to let him shoot it.
He threw it up.
He did, oh, for sure.
Yeah,
exactly.
It doesn't matter whether it has a chance of going in or not.
Absolutely.
He threw it up.
Good presence of mind from Rob Yanders. Rob is a tough competitor. He's going to be feeling this if the Rocks are unable to go through. You know, he had a bereavement earlier on in the season where he had to go home and, you know, his team carried on winning without him, and he came back and was accepted into the fold. You know, he would like to deliver something for the organization.
Yanders heads up both. 24 personal. 24 points for Rob Yanders.
Can't ask too much of the young fella now. I mean, he's doing that, you know. Now we've got Dorsey bringing the ball up. This is the first time they've been trying to exploit the ball handling.
Lobbed into Dorsey.
Great.
Good.
Great help. Gareth Murray gets a call for the slap.
Foul ball of Gareth Murray. Just came down, and it's one of them you often get against the defense and for the offense.
You get that called when you raise your arm. If you raise your arm and bring it down, whether the ref sees anything or not, he's going to think that, you know, you've hit the guy, and you know, you're sending Dorsey. I know he hasn't been great at the line today, Daniel, but you know he's going to put this thing further away. They had got it back to 11 points.
Ooh. He's really had his troubles from the free throw line today. Very unlike Tony Dorsey. As I say, he holds a record, free throw shooting record in playoff finals when he went 16 of 19.
I think when we look at Dorsey and Jeremy Hyatt, Daniel, we'll look at the fact that they're both a little bit older players, a little bit injury prone at this stage of their career, and they put in a tremendous performance yesterday to get their team here. And that just might be just dragging on them as we enter the final stages.
Which is where they've needed somebody like Babalola to step up, which is exactly what he's done. Sterling Davis's three doesn't go. Rebound Robinson, and with 2 minutes to go here, I mean, I'm looking towards the record books now because Newcastle are on pace to have the highest score ever in a playoff final.
Wow.
94 was the best. 94-88, Towers, 94 for Kingston it was against Sunderland, 1991.
Well, that's going back a little bit there.
I remember it well, Vince. I don't know what you're talking about. Oh, it's the year they didn't win the sweep. They lost the cup to Sunderland. But they got their revenge in the playoff final.
Well, aptly, as you mentioned, Sunderland, we're not too far down the road as we're watching the Newcastle Eagles look like they're going to at least retain one of their trophies.
Start nice pass to Murray, who just about dunks it down.
Yep.
Still 12 points between the teams. You're getting into the realms of almost impossible.
Yeah, you see, for the first time, Daniel, we suddenly started pressurizing the guards and we got helter-skelter going on. I'm really disappointed Coach Liebenath didn't do this a little earlier on. No one on this Eagles team is a point guard, and he didn't take advantage of that. I think that's Davis.
Yeah, it is. Foul number four on Sterling Davis. Tony Dorsey will go to the free throw line.
You know, Daniel, the funny thing about fouls when you get onto three and four fouls is, you know, you can take your own self out of the game.
Yeah.
You know, the coach sat him down for a bunch of minutes, and then he thought, I better play tentative, and all of a sudden, you know, he ended up getting a subpar performance for 17 minutes, and the game is done.
Well, I saw a BBL game where the Newcastle Eagles came back from seven down inside 30 seconds. I saw an international game this season where a team lost 8 points in 30 seconds.
Daniel, but put that barrel down.
No, I can't see it. I can't see it right now. I can't see the Rocks turning around 13 points in a minute 14.
No, we've had great BBL performances as well, Daniel. You know, when we look back to John White, you know, bringing his team back to defeat the London Towers and things like this. But in those situations, you had players on that team, you know, performing and actually doing something. I think what we've got here is Robert Yanders has given everything he's got.
Really,
there's nobody else here now able to find something to... the fact is, we're coming to the end of the season in this big game, and Wallace is sitting on the bench. I think that probably says it, really.
Well, Hugo Sturck gets one, cuts it down to 12, but really now it's going to be too little, too late, you would imagine.
And that was our fourth Eagle bringing the ball up the floor. That's how much they've been struggling now that the Rocks have to chase them. You know, I think that was Shawan Robinson trying to bring the ball up the floor.
And I think the referees are now copping a deaf one, as they say, because Coach Liebenak is giving all he's got over on the sideline. As you can see, we don't want to get technical fouls or anything like that.
No, that's nice.
Just ignore it.
No, the refs have done a good job, and I think it's important. They know the young fella is frustrated. Here's a coach adjusting to the life in the BBL. He's done a terrific job with his team and his organization, and I think we're going to see a lot more of Coach Liebenak, as we have obviously seen of Tony Dorsey.
Yander's driving to the hole. We saw a lot of that in the first half, and there's a quick foul, and really all this fouling is doing is prolonging the agony and sending Newcastle ever closer to a record score in a playoff final.
Well, exactly. You've talked about teams coming back, and we've got an 11-point deficit. You know, so at the end of the day, you're talking about it's a four-shot, four-possession game, which means, you know, 4 3-pointers in 58 seconds, assuming the Eagles don't score. Now, obviously, they've put Fab Flannoy on the line, who I was going to say wasn't the Eagles' best free-throw shooter. Having lost the game to Fab on the free-throw line this season, you know, he's a man who gets it done when it matters most.
Yeah, I mean, you can shoot 60%, but if you shoot 80, 90% in the last 2 or 3 minutes of a game, that's all that matters.
Absolutely.
Yanders for three. Got to go. Doesn't. Rebound Dorsey. And it'll be Tony Dorsey who'll walk the length of the floor as Julius Joseph fouls out of the game for the Scottish Rocks. And this is the man that's won the game for the Newcastle Eagles. Most Valuable Player Award will be given to Ola Babalola for his game. Really, it was all done in that first half. He had 17 first half points shot, 4 of 6 from the three-point line. That gave them the platform on which they built.
Absolutely, Daniel, and we're all looking at Tony Dorsey, and we're all looking at Jeremy Hyatt, and this young fella saw an opportunity to put his name in lights, and he's done just that.
Well, we've seen a few records here today. We've just seen the Eagles tie the highest ever score in a playoff final. Tony Dorsey can break it. No, he can't. He can miss it.
Wow.
The other bit of history we've seen is Tony Dorsey in a playoff final. He's not won MVP.
Yeah, that's right.
First time in 4 attempts that Dorsey's not won the MVP.
But you know what? I think Tony Dorsey is absolutely delighted that his team has won, and that's the kind of man he is. And he's finally, you know, in conjunction with Fab and obviously the absent TJ Walker, you know, been able to rebuild that winning attitude with this team, because considering what they lost last season in Charles Smith and Andrew Sullivan, nice to see Fab and his assistant coach there just, you know, thanking each other for the work well done.
Andrew Bridge ticks us up to 95, the highest points total by a team in a playoff final.
Yeah, nice to see an English player wins the MVP, an English player puts us into the record score. You know, the game for the young players is that basically work hard and you could be out there.
And it was 15 points last year. It looks like it's only going to be 13 this year. They will have to shoot it, though. That's the only problem. Newcastle are going to have to shoot it. They'd rather just tick time down, but the shot clock has got less time on it than the game clock.
Well,
so they're trying to do it. They've got to shoot the ball. It's going to be a 24-second violation. The clock will stop. Unfortunately, it's going to happen. It's a 24-second violation, so with 2 seconds to go, the Rocks are going to get the ball back. The fans are already celebrating because the game is over. And now it reaches zero. And the Newcastle Eagles are the 2007 playoff champions. They've won it for the third year in a row, Vince.
Absolutely fantastic. And a credit to Fabulous Flannoy, because, again, they had a really, really tough start to the season, Daniel. and Fab believed in his beliefs and continued to do what he knew best, and eventually won his team around, won his fans back around, and delivered the final trophy of the season to keep the winning tradition going on for the Newcastle Eagles.
Yeah, it was a really great performance in the first half from Babalola that won him the MVP award, and then we saw some good things from the likes of Dorsey, but we saw it from around the team. It came from Bridge as well.
Yes, I mean, you know, Fab has inspired them, but obviously, you know, Dorsey was instrumental. Jeremy Hyatt had a little purple patch. Andrew Bridge, Olu Babalola, Darius Defoe, they all came in there and contributed to what was really a wet day, but a winning day for Fab Flodoy.
Fab got Gatorated over the back there. He got thrown down. It's an old tradition. I haven't seen it for a few years, but it's an old tradition. And Fab Flodoy, well, he'll be well pleased with that shower. And you can see, got to give credit to that man for getting his team to another final and just can't quite get over the hump.
No, he's done well. He stepped into a team that had success in the past and, you know, being in finals and so on. And he's just like not missed a beat, stepped straight in there, imposed his own philosophy on these group of guys and brought them right up to the championship game. Tremendous effort from Thorsten Liebenath.
And there's Paul Blake, the chairman of the BBL, who makes the presentation. I'm sure he'll be pretty pleased, given his Newcastle connections, to be handing that to Fab Flodoy, etc.
Well, as chairman of the BBL, he's got a tough job, and he's obviously done a great job here in Newcastle and continues to do a great job with all the things that he's involved with. I think, you know, the Scottish Rocks, the Newcastle people have had a great day tonight.
Now we're ready then for the presentation. And it really has been a great game of basketball. The Rocks really just faded a little bit in the second half, didn't get enough support for Rob Yanders, but they can be well proud of their season. It's never easy to make it all the way to the final game, and it's even worse when that final game ends in defeat. But in the cold light of summer, you've got to be pleased with the top four finish, place in the championship final. Sterling Davis, really, after he got in foul trouble, struggled to recover. Wallers, wearing number six, thought he was going to be big for them when he hit that three early on, but didn't really get it done. Hugo Sturck goes up, gets his. Rob Yanders, what a performance for Rob. 26 points to lead his team, lead all scorers, in fact. But it wasn't enough to get it done for his team. Julius Joseph, he goes up, doesn't look too pleased with life, does he? Wasn't a game he'll remember. Gareth Murray. Anren goes up, and Maurice Hampton, who did a pretty good job for his team before fouling out. And the coach, Thorsten Liebenach, slaps five with all of his players, as does Ross Hutton, his assistant, before the pair of them go up and get their mementos for the game.
The BBL Championship weekend, Scottish Phoenix, well, the Rocks.
That's the runners-up, and now it's all about the winners, as it is on these occasions. It's all about who takes the beautiful silver and gold basketball home. It is the nicest looking trophy in basketball of the four. Paul Blake just about holding on to it there. And it's the trophy that gets handed away first. And you know that Paul Blake is pretty pleased to be handing this one over to the player coach of his club, Fab Flodoy. Fab Flodoy shakes his hands, a big hug. And now the 2007 playoff champions of the Newcastle Eagles, Flodoy turns to his team, holds it aloft. Holds it aloft to the Eagles fans behind the bench, and then around for the cameras, posing for the pictures. And what a fantastic finish it is to the season for the Newcastle Eagles. Not only have they won the playoffs, but they've done it in their own hometown here on their own court. And after the disappointment of the trophy final earlier on this season, I'm sure this more than makes up for it now, to have that silver and gold basketball in Fab Flodoy's hands. And now the players come up. Well, we said, will Jeremy come back into the game after he picked up that knee injury? And the answer was no, but they didn't need him. He only had 6 points, but he only played 16 minutes before hobbling out, but it was enough. And what a game this guy had. 17 points, 6 rebounds, a couple of big three-pointers for Andrew Bridge. He must have been in the running for MVP as well. Tom Sherlock did what he always does, plays hard for his team. Shawan Robinson, another good performance. I mean, it's good numbers all the way down the list for the Newcastle Eagles. 16 Dorsey. Points for him. Dorsey, not an MVP for the first time in his career in a playoff final. He's been three-time MVP, but 18 points, 13 rebounds, 3 assists. Not enough this time out. Brian McCotter gets his. This is going to be our MVP, Olu Babalola. And the reason is that of his 23 points and 7 rebounds, he hit 4 of 6 threes in that first half that really put Newcastle on their way. That was the bit when Newcastle got in front, and once they got in front, they never gave it up. And Fab Flannoy, the player coach, goes up to get his medal. And Billy Spragg, the assistant coach, will also go up to get his medal. And he shakes the hands with Paul Blake and takes it. Now we've just got the one more presentation to make, which is for the MVP. And you know it, and I know it, but the people in the house don't know it. And it's a golden molten basketball that Paul Blake holds up. And the in-house commentators giving out the stats, teasing the fans, because they don't know who the MVP is just yet. I'll give you to them as well. 23 points, 7 boards. He had a block shot and a couple of steals. 4 three-pointers with the key. And it's Olu Babalola. Gets the slaps from all his teammates. He goes up to receive the golden basketball for his MVP display. And he really was the difference in the first half for the Newcastle Eagles. And he's pretty pleased to have that ball aloft. He's got to go pose for the cameras. Getting too close for them. Step back. And rightly deserved to win MVP. It is a bit strange not to see Tony Dorsey there, given his previous record in playoff finals and his numbers. The double-double in the semi-final and the final for Dorsey, but Olu Babalola really was the difference maker for the Newcastle Eagles here in this game.